Hi, I'm Nakajabu Sims. They call me Naka. I'm here with my brother Troy. We're here to just sit down and talk about our life experiences. And we've both been in and out of the penitentiary. We've both come back into the streets with our struggles and have made it and have turned around the recidivism for ourselves and is in the process of trying to turn around recidivism for others. And hopefully our story today we'll be able to help a couple of y'all out there. I'll turn it over to Troy.
Thank you. As you said, my name is Troy Heintzelman. We're here to share a little bit about the struggles, the stripes, and the burdens that we had to endure in and out through our transition in life. But yeah, so hopefully it does have an impact on somebody. If not, at least we shared our story. It's time for you to share yours.
So, man, let me see. I did my first bit when I was 20. I've been in and out of the county since I was about 16. Caught my first felony when I was 17. I did my first bit when I was 20. penitentiary, boy. You know, it's crazy because you'd have thought that the lifestyle I was... First of all, without the lifestyle, you'd have thought just the way I was brought up and raised that I would have been weary of going to the penitentiary.
Right.
But I loved the lifestyle I was living at the time. And I always would say I knew I was going to the penitentiary. I just didn't know when, how, and how long I'd be.
Right.
And it's crazy because, you know, they say you can speak things into existence. And I spoke those words my whole life. I know I'm going to the joint one day. Mm-hmm. You know, I wasn't even worried. I wasn't scared. I wasn't ashamed to say it. And my last bit is what really got to me. I was sentenced 14 to 50 years, but I ended up only doing 6 because I had it overturned in appeals court. But that was the harsh. That was the hardest time I did.
What was the difference? Not to cut you off.
The difference was mainly the time.
Okay.
The time I was given, the time I went, because I was 24, but I actually was in a mindset of change, and I was ready. Gotcha. Well, at least I thought I was ready at the time. So I was straddling the gate. I had 1 foot in and 1 foot out. So when it hit me, it was harsh. You know, I was engaged.
Gotcha.
You know what I'm saying? I was with my middle son's mother at the time. And I had started working. I had a good job. But I still couldn't quite let the streets go.
Gotcha.
You know, I was confused.
Mm-hmm.
I was scared of change. So when I went to prison on that time, It was emotionally, mentally, and physically hard on me because I was mentally, physically, and emotionally prepared. Every other time I went, I was prepared.
Gotcha.
You know, if that makes sense.
No, I understand.
You know, I mean, I wasn't prepared, but I was ready for it. You know,
living a different lifestyle.
Yeah. So, I went in with a chip on my shoulder.
Gotcha.
You know, in them 6 years, I was stabbed 5 times. I caught an attempted murder case in prison. For a time there, I lost my faith in God. I lost my faith in family. I had lost my faith in humanity. You know, that was the first time throughout all the times I was locked up that I felt like an animal. I knew the true meaning of loneliness, of not feeling important, not feeling loved, feeling like nothing. just thinking about it, man, right now, it hurt, you know?
Mm-hmm.
It was a brutal time for me. As much as I hate prison, though, I can say that time in prison, them 6 years there, probably was the greatest thing that ever happened to me. Yeah. You know, it helped me find out who I was.
Yes, sir.
It helped me find out what I wanted in life.
Mm-hmm.
It helped me find out what I wanted out of life. And in some awkward way, I found out how I was going to obtain and reach those things right. in life, you know? So I got out December 21st of 2010, 4 days for Christmas. And it was a struggle because I came home and I thought I was a changed man. Prison can do that to you because, you know, you live in a controlled environment for so long, you feel like you got control, you know, and I didn't. And one day I woke up like, dang, I'm free. And just like that, my mind went back to that way of thinking. I had to fight it. So, you know, up until 2017, I was still living reckless, you know, still selling drugs, ripping, running the streets, in and out of different women beds, and, you know, just not being the man that I should have been.
Gotcha.
I would go to church sometimes out of guilt.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't go because that's what I wanted to do. I'll go to church because, man, I ain't been in a while. I've been doing some things wrong. I feel like I need to go right now, you know.
Right.
And I'd go for like a couple Sundays. And then boom, I'm done. After, yeah, got my Band-Aid, got the alcohol on it, it's cleaned up.
Yep.
And I'll see church in another 6 months, you know. And that's how I was living. And now, and then like in 2017, I was at a lowest point of my life again. You know, I didn't think it was possible to feel that low without bars.
Gotcha.
And
that's heavy.
I ain't know what else to do. You know, the fact that I was ready to change, the fact that I sobered up, because I started snorting cocaine when I was 13 years old. I started drinking when I was about 11. I started smoking weed when I was 10. You know, so. Those are the years when a person is learning about themselves, learning new feelings, learning how to cope with things. So I had to deal with those emotions, and they was foreign to me. So I didn't know how to deal with them. I didn't know what to do. So, you know, but I got it. I got it together. I fought through it. And here I am talking with you. So, what about you? What was your mental, emotional, and physical battles with it?
They call it a correctional institution. I see the institution, felt the institution, didn't see or feel correction from within the entity. Correction was put on self. I relate to you in the having to deal with feelings and emotions and thinking patterns that were foreign, which should have been normal to us, because I started with addictions at a young age. By the time I was 16, there wasn't a drug I haven't used, and there wasn't a crime I haven't committed. Which led, previous to that, it was my childhood upbringing, not to make that the catalyst or that's why I did what I did. But it set me up to see the perversion of man. It allowed me to see how the systems really work, how there's the lack of compassion for the victims that are in certain scenarios, which led me to a childhood of confusion, hate, anger, resentment, up until the point to when we were in the last shelter, when I turned 12 years old, and I heard them tell my mom that we had to get out because I was considered a threat. For a young boy that was raised in confusion, through abuse, watched his whole family go through abuse, go to foster care, shelter care, in and out, to finally hear that these people that say they care for me, that I'm considered a threat. Which led me to go on my journey. My mom had to find a place for us to live. We go to this farmhouse, you know, out in the boom, you know how it goes. We're out there, and then all of a sudden, our sperm donor, which I call the man who created us, he's a sperm donor, he found us. So we had to come out of hiding. Well, my mom is a single mother with five kids. The inner city is the only place that can afford, she could afford. We moved to the inner city, Burn Heights, after living in shelter institution our whole life. And I was given an opportunity, or what I thought at the time, it was an extension of love. But I was given an opportunity to vent hate, anger, frustration, confusion. And I was accepted for it. And it was okay. Hurt people, hurt people. From that led to, of course, the criminalistic lifestyle, selling drugs, stealing, robbing. I don't need to name the rest, you know. Which then led me to prison. I'm not going to blame the gentleman that told on me. I'm not going to blame my sperm donor for not being there. I'm not going to blame the institutions for setting me on a thinking pattern that I took on. But where I'm at is, once I got into the institution, I was forced to become sober. After I got caught in there with a hunter series shot for dropping dirty. And that's because I had somebody smuggling me marijuana in while I was in prison. So I could make a few dollars and I could get high and I could just do the time and sit back. I got caught. I believe it was my cellie. I know it was my cellie who set me up. Right after smoking a joint, 2 hours later, I get a random drop. Only person I smoked with. Lesson learned. My lesson in life has been my loyalty. I've been loyal to the wrong things because they've accepted me as I am. Every other place I've been into, I've always been an oddity or a misfit. Either not the how I'm perceived because of the color, I'm not that enough, or I'm too urban because of where I grew up. So I've never had a place to really fit in, and I never really cared because I'm going to gravitate to those that gravitate to me regardless. But in the institution, I was still gangbanging. Got caught up, sentenced to 90 days solitary confinement, which you know what that's like.
You're
told you get 3 hours out a week and 3 showers a week, and you're told that. But in that process, I was isolated. I was confined with only myself and my thoughts, the best thing that could ever happen, the worst thing for them. I was able to look at myself. I was able to go through the fears, the withdrawals with the addiction. You know, people say you're not go through withdrawals with marijuana. That's a lie. Sitting in that cell after 2 weeks, getting acclimated to my environment, you see the book cart come by. I was ignorant minded. I didn't want to read, didn't want to educate myself. I was mad because I got told on again, but I kept doing certain things to get told on. Didn't factor that in. Never read a book. This time I see it one day and I grabbed the Bible. It's number one go-to. I started reading through. I'm like, okay, I'm going to read the Bible. I'm here for 90 days. I'm going to read the Bible. Might as well. Got 10 years. I started reading the Bible. Going through Genesis, going through the first 5 books, and then I started to just get angry because it was just taking me on a story. I didn't want to hear somebody else's story. I wanted to hear me, find me. And I've always was told, because I was born and raised in the Word, that there's healing in it. So that's what I was looking for, because I keep finding myself deeper and deeper in a hole by what my choices. Started reading after that, after the anger part, I started reading Proverbs and Psalms. That was my catalyst to change. It taught me how to be a righteous man. It taught me that I am a righteous man. It taught me how to think, how to be empathetic for others, how to take accountability. So with that, I came out of solitary confinement for 90 days, and that was my journey to learn myself, educate myself. Upon coming out, the blue skies were so blue, the green was so green after 90 days staring at bars. I started going on my journey. Then one day I got this youngster, he comes up to me in the chow hall. This was my 5th year in. And he says, he's asking me how to do time, you know, the basic thing. My thing is, don't mess with no boys. You see something, you don't see it. Don't put your mouth on it if you can't back it up.
Yeah.
You'll be fine. And as long as your paperwork comes out clear, you'll be good. As I'm telling them the basic, you know, this is how you do it, I get the nut check from the Holy Spirit. And it was, you're a hypocrite. I was reminded that I was a hypocrite because I'm living this double mind. I'm living double-minded and I'm living a double-style lifestyle. In prison, I'm still gang-banging, trying to educate myself, but I'm doing all the wrong things and jeopardizing my family for other people. Yet when I go in the visit room, I'm talking to my family about growth and development and all the righteousness and all the positive things. So that set me on, it didn't set me, it put me in a position to where I had to make the hardest decision. Do I continue in this lifestyle? Or do I come to the unknown? Through the fear, the intrepidation, I might get poked, I might get checked into PC, whatever. Got that out of my system because I knew I had to do it. My children more important, my family more important. So I had to go tell the brothers, hey, I got to step down, turn it in. Gave them back the money I was holding. And I used our literature as my reasoning to pull away. Because if the literature is set for us to be righteous, why are we living heinous? You know what I mean? These organizations were set to protect the community.
Yeah.
What did we do? We perversed it. That's what man does. But with that, that was my catalyst for change, man. That right there, that walking up through that life to that point. So that's kind of where I'm at with what I feel is necessary to share today. And that way we can be considerate with the time.
Well, now, I've totally changed my life.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I found a new way for growth and development.
Yep.
And my growth mentally, emotionally, physically, and spiritually is so beyond what I expected it to be.
Yes, sir.
At this point in time in my change.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm employed.
Gotcha.
I'm loving it.
Yes, sir.
You know, I remember telling him, I'm going to start with the grunt work. You know, I just need somebody to open up a door and give me the opportunity.
Yes, sir.
And people from where we've been should be able to respect that more. But for some weird reason, they don't. I feel it's up to people like me and you to show them that it can happen. If I can lower my standards to work for $20 a month, I can lower my standards to work for $10 an hour.
Yes, sir.
When I came home and they offered me $10 an hour, I said, huh? I was making 13 cents an hour. You mean you're going to add more to that?
10? What?
You know, so.
Level up.
So, yeah, I had a decimal in my pay, you know what I'm saying? So, with that, it gave my life value. It gave it substance. And it also showed people that I was trying.
Gotcha.
And when I was able to prove and show that I wanted better,
those
that always knew I could do better and wanted better for me had no problem helping me obtain more.
Gotcha. Yep.
You know, us as men have a habit of being prideful. We have to put our egos aside and do what we have to do. We have to show our sons what being a man is. And being a man is being emotional sometimes. Being a man is backing down sometimes. Thinking that backing down makes you less of a man actually makes you less of a man just to think that way.
Yes, sir.
You know, men cry. Men get hurt. Men hurt. Men hug. Men show compassion. Men can be sensitive.
Yes, sir.
You know, that's what being a man is. And when I learned how to be, when I learned what being a man was, I was able to put the criminalistic life away.
Yes, sir.
Because in some weird way, I thought the lifestyle I was living made me a man. And I felt like one too.
Right.
And it's crazy because now that I know what being a man is and I have my life together, that good feeling that I feel now as being a man, at some points in my life, in my criminal ways, I felt that. But it wasn't, it was in moments. I wake up every day with this feeling of a man,
yes,
you know?
Sir. Yes, sir.
I don't have to watch my back. You know, if the cops pull me over, I'm happy to show them my ID.
Yep.
You know, I'm happy. Let's talk.
Yeah.
What you want to know? I'm Arthur. You want to check this mug? You want to check you want to check the car? You show? Okay. You know,
it's different.
Not being annoyed, not being paranoid, not being scared, man. Mm-hmm. Loving myself.
Yeah.
You know,
key.
Being able to love myself the way someone else loved me. Mm. You know, I could accept love from somebody else, but I couldn't accept love for myself.
Gotcha.
I didn't know how to love myself. So, you know, now here I am on a board of advisories,
yes, sir,
for a nonprofit, 70x7. Here I am director of operations for my company that I work, my employer, Junk King Junk Removal, partner with Junk King Junk Removal. You know, motivational speakings, doing seminars, and here I am, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought I wasn't even going to be able to put the bag down.
Mm-hmm. You just picked a different one up.
And here I am.
Mm-hmm. Let me ask you a question. Since you've had multiple times going in and out, and you noticed the change in the last one because of your life, the way it was laying out, and then you were angry because you were making that change, and then you got hiccuped, so to speak. Do you believe that it was going into prison that sparked the change? Or was it you changed before you went into prison slowly, and you were seeing what you were about to have in the walk you were walking? Was that what made you change, or was it going into the institution?
Man, I ain't changed until 2 years ago.
Okay.
I was scared to let go. That lifestyle and that street life was my comfort zone.
Mm-hmm.
I knew how to deal with anything that came to me, whether it was good or bad.
Okay.
I didn't know how to accept change. And when I was touching change, things was happening. And like I say, I had so many foreign emotions and feelings that I never dealt with. So when those feelings would come to me, I would go back to what I knew.
Gotcha.
Because I knew how to accept that. I knew how to deal with,
yep,
that. So I had a good idea of changing.
Mm-hmm.
I had the intent to change. Was I ready to change? No. The institution planted a seed.
Gotcha.
I thought about it, like it hurt because I was in the process of changing, but I really wasn't changing, because when you change, you let it all go. So I wanted my cake and eat it too.
Yep.
And that, you know, everybody goes through that want my cake and eat it too stage before you change.
Yes, sir.
Because to change, you have to have some of it in you first.
Mm-hmm.
You don't just jump from one to another.
That's right.
You know, you have to, and you straddle, because you have to. I had to balance it out. I had to see it for myself.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and even after the prison 6 years, it still took me 6.5 more years to actually start to change.
Yeah.
But the seed was planted, and it just grew slowly.
Gotcha. Okay. For me, on this side of the change, it always brings me back to a question I got from this, I'd say kid, but I don't know, probably a teenager. I was, when I worked at Michigan Works, I was talking to him about my life story, because he was complaining about his life story. And most people perceive, just because you're working or you have a shirt and tie on, that you don't have a story. So I started to tell him a little bit about my story. And I had him Google my name, so he knew it was real, because, as you know, we Google our name, it shows all of our court,
mm-hmm,
documents. And I let him do that, and then he asked me a question after some conversation. He was like, can I ask you a question? Was it harder to change, to adapt going into prison? Or was it harder to change coming out of prison? To that stuck with me, you know,
mm-hmm,
what I mean? Because, of course, you want to give someone an answer right away, you know, you don't want to leave them hanging. So I gave him just the fluff, but in thought, you know, it's like, I have to say the change is harder coming out of prison. Because everyone's expecting you, whether they know you or not, especially those that do, they expect you to be this certain person. And even though you are you, but your mind changes. Your life experiences have altered your perception and how you view things.
Yeah.
And it's, you come home and everybody's got an agenda for you, whether it's your probation officer, it's FOC if you have to deal with them, it's your family, it's your children, it's all these other responsibilities that were on hold for however long. I did 10, so all my stuff was on responsibility on hold for 10 years. And then I come out and it's, I'm trying to rush into this position that most are running away from.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? I know the damage I've done to my family by going into prison because their life stopped.
Yep.
All they see is what's on TV, what they show on TV about prison. You're getting bent over, you're getting raped, you're getting stuck and all that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
That happens. But that's usually consensual. Or there's something behind why it happens.
Yeah.
But those experiences stay with you, man. And there's a spirit inside the institutions, which I know you know, that stays with you as well. You
gotta shake it.
And as you come out, everyone is testing you with their checklist for you to do. And then it comes to a point to where you get almost burned out because you had a plan while you were in, hopefully. You set up to what you were gonna do. You come out, and then you try to do these things. And it gets thrown in your face. Everything I planned for, I'm not doing today. I thought I was going to be doing physical therapy, making 70, 80 grand a year, telling people how to bend and stretch. I was going to be doing good, man. Come home, find out it's not my reality.
Yeah.
That's not what I wanted, what he has for me. I also wanted to do other different types of businesses. Hasn't happened. I walked into a job at Michigan Works with no experience. That's him. From that experience, it's led me to now where I'm working with 70x7, where I'm able to share my life experiences,
mm-hmm.
no holds barred, and share my faith. And in that opportunity, I'm able to plant a seed through my experiences and the life experiences I've been through into some soil.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where the problem gets in this type of work, is because people feel that the soil is tainted.
Yeah.
Well, they forget you need manure and soil to make things grow.
Yeah.
So that's what I love. Keep me around the manure. But in my change, the hardest thing, besides following all these checklists for everybody else, it's nobody really believes that that's really who you are.
Yeah.
No matter what you do, you're always going to be looked at one way. And you know it.
Yeah.
No matter how many times they smile on your face, pats on your back, they're always waiting for that opportunity for you to show who you really are. That's the burden that we have to carry in this walk. And I believe that that burden right there is what drives most people back to that lifestyle, back to the bottle, back to the needle, or whatever your choice may be. So that's what I love about us, not just you and I, but individuals like us,
yes,
that have had life experience, not just prison, life experiences, and are standing in a position to speak to those that are currently in it. Because how many people did you really honestly have speaking at you when you were in your lifestyle or in your mess, trying to pull you out of it? And if they were, had they ever lived it?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And that's where we got to use our life experiences. So that was kind of like my burden of the change and transition. I mean, there's other situational stuff, but that's life, man.
Yeah.
It's life.
So do this in 30 seconds. If you ran into somebody,
mm-hmm.
in your shoes before you got to where you at right now,
mm-hmm.
like when you was on the brink of giving it all up and making that full life change, mm-hmm. in 30 seconds, what would you tell that person?
Do you love yourself? Everything starts with love. You know that through your change. And this is outside, because that's all I'm gonna tell him. Do you love yourself? And if he says, let's say, yes. Okay, what is love? Because if an individual doesn't know the actual definition of the things they say that they have, how do you really know what you have? And if you say you love yourself, then why would you conduct yourself in certain manners that go against the love that you say you have for yourself? That's kind of the way I would get them. And then if he said no, well, then that's where we start. We go into teaching him what the actual definition of love, not my verbiage, because I want him to get a understanding of what the definition is. Now, go and find it, because I can't teach you love. That's something you got to take on and give to others. So that's what love is. It's what you give to others. You know, it's the action. Yep. It's not in the receiving. It's the giving, the sacrificing. So that's where I would start, in the love, because if you ain't got love, you ain't going nowhere.
I appreciate it, brother. For sure.